Are you struggling to conceive? You have options, and at Piedmont Reproductive Endocrinology Group, we'll make sure you have the guidance and support you need. PREG is known for individualized fertility care that's unique to every patient. We take the time to provide a reassuring and empowering experience because we believe that you deserve nothing less. Let us help you on your journey to parenthood. Visit us at pregonline.com to learn more. Get the guidance and support you need at Piedmont Reproductive Endocrinology Group.
With Lucky Land Slots, you can get lucky just about anywhere.
This is your captain speaking. We've got clear runway and the weather's fine, but we're just going to circle up here a while and get lucky. No, nothing like that. It's just these cash prizes add up quick. So I suggest you sit back, keep your tray table upright, and start getting lucky.
Play for free at LuckyLandSlots.com. Are you feeling lucky? No purchase necessary. Void where prohibited by law. 18 plus terms and conditions apply. See website for details.
Happy birthday! It's your birthday! It's your birthday! So let's go party tonight! Happy birthday!
Okay, Eric. All right, so we're recording this on your birthday, so I thought I'd play this really cool song. What do you think, man?
Well, I'm not familiar. So I know Happy Birthday by Stevie Wonder.
Okay, it's not
the kind of the classic. Well, I know, but I mean, I know the classic one. I do not recognize that one at all, but very catchy. I mean, I liked it.
Yeah, no, that's actually a song from a band that I used to hang out with called the Prom Kings. It's called Happy Birthday. So happy birthday to you. Yay,
Eric's
birthday.
Thank you. By the way, great band name, by the way. Prom Kings,
right? I like that. Yeah, they're not together anymore.
put that down as a show idea. We need to talk about best band names.
Best? Yeah, like our top three.
Yeah, like top three best band names, the one that are most descriptive of them. Speaking of the show, we are...
Should we introduce ourselves?
We should introduce ourselves. I am Eric Leckie, otherwise known as Birthday Boy.
And I am Chris Donovan, and you can follow me on Twitter, Chris_Donovan, and you can listen to my alternative rock countdown show that I do every weekend. It's called Alt Mixed Up. Go to altmixedup.com. You can find a Facebook page there, and, you know, I post from time to time. But not all the time, so don't be a jerk and be like, where are you?
Yeah, don't be a jerk. Basically, that sums up a lot of things.
But what's your Twitter handle? What's your favorite social media
mine
threads?
Mine is at Sinatra's Rat Pack on Twitter. We should be better at this. We should be better at almost everything in life. But it's funny. So you brought up Prom Kings, which I thought was a good name. Another pretty decent name that I saw over the weekend. I took my daughters on Sunday to go to this thing called the Big Adventure. It was concert, comic book kind of a thing down at the Orange County Fairgrounds.
Oh, cool.
It was pretty cool. I mean, it wasn't as big as they kind of made it out to be. You thought it was going to be this huge thing that was going to be the best thing ever. And you get there and it was cool, but not as big as, you know, as all that.
Was that coinciding with BlizzCon? Because BlizzCon, I think, was at Orange County or Anaheim this weekend. I don't even know what BlizzCon is. Okay.
And I think they were trying to piggyback onto that. So that's kind of what they were doing.
Okay.
But anyways, they had some bands play. But speaking of good names, one of the bands we saw last night with my daughters was Cold War Kids. And I thought about it. I'm like, that's a great name because if you're born in the 80s, you know, the Cold War officially ended in 1989 when they tore down the Berlin Wall. So if you were born between 1980 or, you know, even 78, 77, somewhere in that range to about 1988, 89, you are a Cold War kid. You grew up in the era where we all thought we were going to die from Mother Russia at any moment. Not that things have changed too much, but
they're just killing us internally.
They're from the inside. But I thought that was a great band name. If you're born in the 80s, you're a Cold War kid.
I wasn't born in the 80s, so I think I'm just 70s, forgotten.
Yes. Yeah. I also just came from, because this is always something people want to do on their birthday, I just came from the dentist. In fact, I'm so fresh from the dentist, I still have the numb face. I still have the numb lips and everything.
And oddly enough, we are recording this podcast at 2:30. So, I mean, it just all fell in line.
Yeah.
That's a dad joke.
Actually, wow, that is a good dad joke.
2:30? Come on, man.
That was pretty good. My daughter's grown at every one of my dad jokes, and it makes me – what they don't realize is it just makes me want to tell more of them.
100%.
100%. Like when they groan and they say, oh, that's such a dad joke, I'm like, well, I was going to give up on these, but now I got 100 more.
Right. They sit in the bathroom and write down dad jokes.
But, you know, at the dentist, it was making me think
I hate the dentist.
Who likes the dentist?
I don't.
Honestly, who likes the dentist? And I got to say, and we have actually have a couple friends that are dentists and everything, but if you become a dentist, who chooses that? Unless you're following in the footsteps, you know, your dad was a dentist and it's an easy way into the field or whatever. Ignoring that. Let's say you just say, I want to use little tiny instruments in people's mouths, cause lots of pain, cause discomfort. You're a masochist, right? Like giving people pain.
Or you're just, you know, you're too afraid to go in the dominatrix field and you're like, yes, I'll just do it in small stints. Oh, yeah. Or not good looking enough. That too would work. But there's masks involved with those things. Probably. Maybe. I don't know.
Yes, actually, very good point. There are masks involved. A lot of binding up materials. Think about it. I think you're onto something. They put things in your mouth to restrict movement. They shove those cotton wads in there to. I mean, you got hooks and.
Whoa! Shoving cotton wads. Calm down there.
I didn't mean for this to turn racist.
Ouch!
But no, I feel that it is just you almost have to be a masochist if you want to become a dentist.
Yeah, no, I it's not something I ever wanted to go into because, one, I hate sitting in there, and just the thought of having to go to the dentist does give me a little anxiety. I do have a good friend who is our dentist. He's a nice guy and all, but I should probably ask him that question. He'd probably come up with – he's hilarious. He tweets me or texts me weird texts all the time that are probably inappropriate for a professional in his field, so I don't share them with other people. So he'd probably come up with an answer like, oh, yeah, no, I just want to make people's gums bleed. That's the only reason I got into dentistry, or I like yanking teeth. Yeah. We should really be better at this.
And think about they should. And think about this too, is they got into a profession where you're coming into contact with people every single day, but yet you're not really having conversations with them, because the only thing you could say in a dentist chair is like you can only groan certain either like when they ask you if it hurts or not or what have you. So you've chosen a profession where you can't talk to anyone.
Yeah, no, and the funny thing is right when they ask you a question, it's like you just took a bite at your table and the server just walked up and said, do you need anything else? But they're at the same time, they're putting in that suction in your mouth, or they're squirting water in your mouth. Is everything okay? And they can understand you, which is creepy enough, but the fact that they wait until they do something in your mouth to ask you how you're doing is hilarious.
Right, and you were a server for a while. You did some serving stuff. Do they do that on purpose?
I do.
Or is that just like, okay.
No, I did that shit on purpose all the time. I was never your regular run-of-the-mill server. I was always a smart ass to one degree or another, just because it was a...
Shocking.
It's a job that's monotonous and boring, and I mean, it's like basically you work in a restaurant, which is also like a, you know, everybody sleeps with everybody at restaurants, and this is true. Like, if you haven't seen the movie Waiting with Justin Long and Ryan Reynolds, everything that is in that movie is true. So yeah, no, I was always a smartass. There's always that lady that's always like, oh, I'm hardcore, like, but in the back she's like, I hate everybody, and then she turns the corner, she's like, hi, how are you? So yeah, so I did do that shit on purpose all the time. It was fun.
Yeah, that's horrible. you're just a horrible person.
Okay.
Also on Sunday was the end of daylight saving time. And yes, I'm one of those people that knows how to say properly daylight saving time, not savings. But I got a question for you, Chris.
Okay.
Is this the stupidest idea ever? Can we stop it with this changing of time? Do we think we're gods?
No, it doesn't. It was logical. Back in the day, so farmers would be up at certain times and stuff. But now, you know, we don't farm anymore. We put everything in a warehouse with some hydroponics and then, you know, instant weed other crops too, I'm sure.
Well, there are other crops from what I hear.
Yeah, right. There are other things that people use that are called crops. But yeah, no. Do we need it? Nah, I don't think we need it anymore. I think we're all smart people now and we get it. My first question is, when it was first instituted for farmers and stuff, I mean, did any of them really have, like, clocks? Did it matter?
That's an excellent point, because I think – yeah, well, they had those, like, little pocket watches that would, like, hang from their vest. But you're right. That's a good point. The other thing I thought about is – you know what I'm sick and tired of? And I've been a boss most of my career. You know, I've always been in management of some sort, so I have employees, right?
Well, let me clarify. He's always been paid to be in charge of people.
Being
a boss, quote unquote, probably something that's happened once or twice.
Thank you for the clarification.
You're welcome.
So
continue.
So I'm so tired of the excuse of, oh, my clock, my alarm didn't go off because of the change in time. It was always an excuse for people to be late for one thing or the other. in my opinion, the first year that they implemented this is the one and only time where I think that is an acceptable excuse. Imagine back in, you know, like 1905 or 1877 or whenever the hell this was first instituted. That first, like, time that the time changes and, like, Zechariah and Ezekiel or whatever the hell were their names back then.
Jesus.
Like, we're late to church on Sunday or whatever. It was, sorry, it didn't go off. The time change messed me up. That's the only time it's ever been acceptable. Since then, sorry, we all have digital clocks. It changes on your cell phone. There's no excuse.
Yeah, no, you're funny. You're stereotyping people name Ezekiel and stuff. That was good. I like that. No, but you are right. It doesn't make sense to do it anymore. I mean, now I'm going to be driving to work in the sun, which I was before, but I'll be driving home in the dark the whole way.
Yes, the whole way, which makes your drive like 80% worse.
Yes, and it's already 1,000% horrible. So it's, yes. You know, you do the math there.
But I'm not good at math, so let's move on. Speaking of math, this is another story I thought I got a huge laugh out of that I thought you'd enjoy. So I was watching the news, and, you know, California real estate prices are insane, almost anywhere you live.
Tell me
about
it.
I say that I live in the LA area, but I live on the absolute outskirts of LA, but I'm still in the LA area because it's super expensive to live where I live. Chris lives 800,000 miles away. He's the distance from the moon away from Los Angeles. And you have a deal. You are in a really nice house. I'm sure you got a hell of a deal. But it still wasn't cheap way out there when you consider other parts of the country.
L.A. County is ridiculous. It's super It's super difficult to own. I can't move close to my job because I can't afford it.
Yes.
But the job's good enough where it's okay. I can make the sacrifice of driving.
You're willing to drive. Think of it. For people out there, think about it. He's willing to drive 4 hours a day because that's where he could afford to live making a good salary. But my point in this is Los Angeles aside and how big of an area that covers – if you're going to name one other place, not just in California, but in the nation,
yes,
that was just as expensive and probably worse, would be San Francisco. And so that's why this news really
surprised
me. Okay. So San Francisco real estate prices are insane, and San Francisco is an absolute shithole. Forgive my language, but it's an absolute shithole. My wife and I used to love going there. You go there now, and it's filled with feces and heroin needles. What's funny is
– sounds like a good time.
Yeah. You could shit on the street. You could flick heroin needles at passerby. But yet if you use a straw from Starbucks, you're under arrest because you can't have a plastic straw. That's how stupid that city is. Anyways, there's the cheapest property for sale in San Francisco.
Yes.
Just went on a price reduction because they couldn't sell it.
Whoa.
Well, let's see here. Are you thinking, okay, it got reduced. It's just a condo. So
there's definitely not houses. Now. Not a whole lot of houses for sale in San Francisco in the 2 or 3 mile radius that it is.
Well, let me tell you, this one is only 480 square feet. That's about the size of your living room.
It's actually about the size of my daughter's room.
Yes. One bedroom, one bath, 480 square feet. They just lowered the price to only
$599,000. That's it? Oh,
yeah.
Shit. I'll go buy that tomorrow.
I got that in the loose change in my couch, but
yeah.
That's insane. That is an insane – because imagine you plop down that money and you're thinking to yourself, honey – we made a wise investment. This thing can only go up.
You know what happens next?
Yeah.
9 months later, they have a kid and they go, oh, man, we screwed up. Where the hell are you going to put the baby?
Selling that place.
Yeah, right? Where's the baby going to go? Like, you bought a one bedroom, one bath. That's got to be for absolutely one person or a couple, and they never want to have kids. So, which happens out here a lot in LA. There are a lot of people that do that because that's just the culture out here. But there's no way that would ever I could ever do that. That's more than my 4-bedroom house on a third of an acre in Riverside.
Yeah, and what's insane is San Francisco – listen, we also have a lot of earthquakes out here, and you don't have to be that old to remember. There's been some pretty nasty earthquakes that have hit that area. You're also investing a hell of a lot of money essentially on top of a fault, also near a place that could flood, also near a place that could have storms. Oh, and there's feces and needles all over the place. So like literally – you're investing in like what can almost be a war zone. It's just not a good investment. That's a ton of money.
Not to mention you're really close to where all those gorillas and those apes and those monkeys escaped and live now in the redwoods. So you're literally sitting on the front line of being killed and overrun by apes. It's just not worth it. And the prison that's in the ocean there. I mean, people escape from there all the time. Ugh, whatever.
It's insane. And why do people even live there or root for teams from that area?
You know what? I wasn't going to go there, but you're right. San Francisco should not exist anymore. And while you're taking San Francisco away, you know what? Take Oakland too, because nobody wants it. Even the Raiders, they're leaving the Vegas.
They're gone. You know what? We're going to call the Bay Area. We've carved it out.
The good Bay Area.
Sold it off. We've carved it out, and we're going to remove it from the continental United States. We're going to sell it to China. That's my plan.
We could, or we could just put a big wall around it and throw all the convicts in there and be like, good luck.
Good luck, and fend for yourselves. That would be great news. Other good news, another story I saw that you would like. Seal Beach, which is close to us. I love it. Great little neighborhood, great little beach right there. I go there all the time with the family.
Mm-hmm.
There's a donut shop that's been there forever, and a really sweet story out of there too was that the owner of the bakery's wife has brain cancer and is in the hospital, but he still has to work to pay her bills. So what the community has done is they show up every morning at like 6 a.m., 5 a.m. to buy all of his donuts that he has in stock so that he has enough money, he closes up and can go be with his wife in the hospital.
Oh, I would make triple and quadruple the amount of donuts I've ever made before in my existence of life if these people are going to do that.
Yes. And watch, you're going to find out like years later his wife's in remission. She's doing just fine. But he's like, honey, stay in the back. Don't show your face. I'm still making these donuts.
Right. I went from selling 150 donuts a day to 3,000. Yes. Come on, woman. Calm down. Like, brain cancer might be worth it.
Yeah. Do you have to recover so fast? I mean, geez. Jesus, think of the business.
What's the name of the place? We got hose?
I think it's literally just – oh, nice. Very nice. I just think it's called Seal Beach Donuts, which is, you know, plain name. But
it's descriptive, I guess.
Yeah, I thought that was pretty good news. I would like to talk about a couple of movies.
Hold on. Let's not go there yet. I have one more thing that I got to cover. First, it was my 10th anniversary yesterday.
Hey, congratulations.
Thank you. We're recording this on your birthday, and my 10th anniversary was on November 4th. I've been married to my wife for 10 years, and I actually was able to afford an appropriate size ring for her. Being that when we got married, let's just say we had a six-month-old.
Yes.
So anyway, if you do listen to this, wife, which I don't know if you will or not, happy anniversary. I love you. And now, Eric, we can go to the movies.
And Evelyn, you are when they say the better half, you are like the better two-thirds.
I appreciate that. I've actually come up. Last time I was a better quarter. I was a less quarter. You know what?
Math is really not our strong point.
Let's not do that.
Let's move on to movies.
Okay.
Oh, hooray for Hollywood. It's really got me. Hooray.
So I want to talk about two movies just really quickly that I saw that we've always kind of talked about. It's in the zeitgeist of the show, the things that we talk about.
Yeah.
But they have a common thread, and the thread between the two are the critics do not like these movies. These movies are scoring quite low, but the audience really liked them if you're looking on Rotten Tomatoes. And there's this huge gap between the two. And I am talking about Venom and Bohemian Rhapsody. Now,
you saw both of them?
I saw both of them, and I will talk about Bohemian Rhapsody first, just on the basis that the critics, you know, it's not that they hate this movie, but it's only a 60 in Rotten Tomatoes, which is not very high, but the audience score is 95%, because I could totally see how this is the case, because it is a very enjoyable movie, which is why I thought the audience would like it. The music is great. The performance the performance by Rami Malek is insane. I mean, one of the better performances since Jamie Foxx's portrayal of Rey.
Yeah, okay.
It's that good of a performance. But it's not very good story. So that's why I could see why critics
don't spoil
didn't
it.
Like it. No, not spoiling it, because everyone kind of knows, you know, I don't think you need to be living under a rock to know the guy got AIDS and died. I mean, that's not
– That happened to Venom? Oh my god.
Yeah, and what's funny is they really didn't address it in, I thought, a very professional way.
I heard that when they were making the movie, that the whole premise of the movie – and there was another frontman that was supposed to be doing it, but he stepped away because he didn't like the direction it was going, because he wanted to focus more on Freddie Mercury and getting AIDS and dying and stuff. But they actually took a step back and they're like, no, we need to make it about the music, because the music is what pulled – I mean, they had some epic songs. I mean, Another One Bites the Dust, obviously Bohemian Rhapsody, but everybody loves their music. So they wanted to focus more on the music angle and not the movie. It's not a Freddie Mercury movie. It's a movie about Queen.
Right, and this would be a good time. I actually wanted you to play a clip. This is going to be Freddie Mercury. This is just him singing. An engineer has removed all of the backing vocals, and this is him just singing solo, Somebody to Love. Go ahead and play it.
I work hard every day of my life. I work till I ache my bones at the end. I take home my heart and pay all on my own. I go down to my knees.
So his voice is absolutely stunning. I mean, this is him hitting high notes. He was able to hit a couple of octaves higher than the average singer, so he had this amazing range. Most people don't know he recorded an opera album. Like, he actually sang opera. I mean, this guy had the chops, right? It was amazing.
Oh, yeah. He could wail. As they so eloquently put it in Wayne's World, which I think gave this song and this band another rejuvenation back in the
90s. Yes, with a whole new generation.
Mm-hmm, totally.
Yes, you're absolutely right. But what made this movie interesting is – you're absolutely right. You hit the nail on the head. This movie could have been an all-time classic if I think they would have delved into the deeper, darker stuff, like the AIDS and what he went through and the drinking and the drugs and some of the stuff that I think they really could have worked on. Instead, they went the route of concentrating on the music, and the story suffered, but the performance gained. Like, okay, you sacrificed one for the other. I kind of would have liked to have seen this movie as a straight drama instead of, hey, do you like Queen? Then check out this movie. I wanted it to be where you could take someone who didn't know Queen or Freddie Mercury and get this like super dark. The guy went through some really rough times, and the movie barely touches on that. But if you're looking for a performance that, in my opinion, should be nominated for Academy Award this year, Rami Malek as Freddie Mercury was amazing.
Mr. Robot. Yeah, no, this movie was a cash grab for sure. I mean, just having the name Bohemian Rhapsody be the name of the movie – they've already got a built-in audience, and they did it right. They did it the way they wanted to do it, for one. And two, you just said it, Rotten Tomatoes. The critics didn't like it, but the fans did. So the critics, you know, their job is to watch movies and analyze them for certain ways and certain things and storyline and all that stuff. Well, the audience, well, we're a lot dumber than that. So we want to go in and we want to listen to it and see things. I agree with you that, you know, it could have been better probably for Freddie Mercury, and I have not seen the movie yet, so I can't talk too far about it. But what I can say is I'm excited to see it just because of the music.
Yeah, and you'll like it. Like, you'll walk out, you know, if you're in a theater, you watch at home or what have you, you'll walk away saying, that was pretty good. And wow, that was a really good performance. But you won't walk away saying, that was a really deep story, or wow, I didn't know that about him. It's very superficial, very surface stuff.
I'm hoping I walk out and be like, I'm glad I got a fat bottom girl.
Well, yes, really odd song by him. But
I know, especially since he was not into them.
He was not into them at all, even though he had a longtime girlfriend that actually he proposed to, but it was a cover. You know, she was just like there to make it look like he wasn't a homosexual. The movie is still quite good. I think you would like it, and the music is obviously top notch.
Yeah, I'm down. I'm sold.
But
logo.
The next one that was just like that, where the critics really don't like it, but the audience does, is Venom. I also saw Venom over the weekend. Saw it with my daughter, who was insanely excited to see it. She's been waiting for Venom. This is one that had been on her list. You know, when Marvel releases ahead of time all their movies that are coming out.
Yes.
And like the schedule. In fact, you probably know it better than I do. But when she saw this like 2 years ago, she was already like, okay, I'm ready, I'm in, let's do this. She was all in.
I think one of the biggest selling points with this movie is Tom Hardy. He is loved in the comic book action movie genre. So people are going to give it a shot just because of that. And I mean, he killed the performance of Bane in The Dark Knight Rises.
Yeah.
Every movie he's in, he covers his face with something, but still.
In every movie he's in, you can't understand a word he says.
I don't know what you're saying. I sound like Yoda. I can't even do it.
Every time you do it, you do Yoda. Yeah.
Yoda, it is. Oh, no, it's not. So.
Write that down. Show idea. You do the entire show as Yoda as Bane.
I would. Get that. The chateaus, you people. Yoda as Bane. I'm writing it down. But no, I'm excited to see it. The only reason I haven't seen it is because we've been super busy lately with a whole bunch of other different things. The one thing I think that is exciting people about it, one, it's a standalone Venom movie, because Venom was only introduced, what, back when Topher Grace played him?
Right. He was such a side character.
Was that Tobey Maguire's Venom? Spider-Man. It was like a third Tobey Maguire, but they also had Sandman in there too, and they also put another couple other ones in there. So they like hit him and like buried him. So people wanted more of that. That was the part of that movie that people really wanted, and they – they were hoping they got it from this, and it sounds like they might have got enough of it to make them happy. But again, I have not seen it, can't talk too much on it, but I will go see it. I'll probably take the kid and the boy in the next couple weeks.
So no spoilers or anything, because it's not the story of Venom. And see, this, in my opinion, is one of the things that made the movie suffer. So just like Bohemian Rhapsody, except for more so, Bohemian.
With Lucky Land Slots, you can get lucky just about anywhere.
This is your captain speaking. We've got clear runway and the weather's fine, but we're just going to circle up here a while and get lucky. No, nothing like that. It's just these cash prizes add up quick. So I suggest you sit back, keep your tray table upright, and start getting lucky.
Play for free at LuckyLandSlots.com. Are you feeling lucky? No purchase necessary. Void where prohibited by law. 18+ terms and conditions apply. See website for details.
In Rhapsody, I'm like, you know what? I still thought it was a good movie. Yes, it could have been stronger, but it was still a good movie. Venom was definitely where I'm split. It was super fun. I mean, special effects were great. Some of the one-liners were great. Be prepared for it to be a little dirty. I mean, not Daredevil.
Deadpool.
Deadpool dirty.
Should be, though.
But you know, a lot of cussing, a lot of stuff like that. But for
Is it rated R? Is Venom rated R?
It probably should be. There's a decent amount of foul language in here. I don't remember if it was. It was just one of those ones where you're like, oh, that's actually a lot of cussing. Not that I cared at the end of the day, but just, you know, a little bit more than what you would think of from I know this is an official Marvel movie, but just from that world. And it was really fun. Great one-liners, fun little characters, special effects were cool, all the cool things that you would want in a movie. But is this going to rank up there with the Guardians of the Galaxy, where you could watch it when it comes on TV in 5 years?
No.
You're going to be like, yeah, no, it doesn't rise up to that level. And it's because the story is weak. So I don't think I'm really revealing any major plot points. But basically, you don't have good – when you have a movie that is a lot of inner dialogue because Venom is talking to the Tom Hardy character –
Okay.
You know what I mean? So you have him walking down the street talking to himself. Eddie Brock is talking to himself between having an argument between him and Venom, like he's a psychopath on the street, right?
Okay.
So when you have a movie that's really heavily dependent on something you really can't see talking, which is Venom.
Yeah, because he's that growth over him.
You kind of need to have a strong character. You have to have that character strongly developed. And so what winds up happening is if they don't develop Venom, which they really didn't, he's just a blob that moves around that talks in a tough voice, almost like Michael Keaton doing Batman. And
where's Lau? So, sorry, go ahead.
Yeah, but what happens is you wind up having this character who's – you haven't really developed enough. There's not enough character there. So when there's this inner struggle in the movie or there's this switch and change of heart, you're not really invested into the character Venom. You're more bought into, oh, he could like rip people's heads off and that's kind of cool and the special effects are cool.
My question is if – was this just one of those Marvel movies that they had to make because he's going to show up in the next Spider-Man movie?
And you hit it – yes. That is exactly what I was leading to, which is that as it finished, of course, my daughter was all geeked out on it because they could have laid a big turd and she still thought it was like the greatest thing ever. She loved it. But after we talked about it afterwards, we were both in agreement that this was a setup movie. This was a
Doctor Who, or not a Doctor Who, yes. God, Doctor Strange.
Doctor Strange, perfect example. You're nailing it. So you already, but Doctor Strange was a good movie.
Yes, it was.
I thought it was actually quite good. I actually still have not seen the whole thing. I don't know the ending. I saw 2/3 of it. I still need to see the ending.
You've seen Avengers Infinity War, right?
Yes.
That's your ending.
There you go.
There's your ending.
There you go. So what it's exactly just like that, where they're literally doing this because you know Venom is going to play some sort of role in some sort of future movie. And they wanted to develop the character so that when they bring him out, it's not like, oh, who's Venom? And I sure wish I knew his backstory. That's all it is.
Yeah, no, it was definitely, I think, a setup for him to be coming out in the next Spider-Man movie or maybe the next Avengers Infinity War, because Iron Man is in space still and so is Spider-Man, you know? So
right.
Does
Venom go up and pull Iron Man back down? Or, I mean, like there's, you know... They were trying to set it up because he's introduced as a bad character, but by the end he's a good character in your typical change, which happens in every one of these movies. And it's a Loki kind of a thing. And you just look at it, you're like, okay, that's just setting it up for the next time. Like that's how it essentially you're left with. And you're not left with any feeling of like, wow, that was like an emotional roller coaster or anything. You're just like, oh, a bunch of stuff exploded and there were some cool one-liners and the movie ended.
Oh, well, there you go. It's like a worse version of Guardians of the Galaxy.
No, Guardians of the Galaxy is a great movie.
No, I know.
I wouldn't. No, but I would say this would be like
five-word review. Five words. That's all you get. Give me your review.
Five-word review.
One?
Desperate need of a Spider-Man.
Ooh, Spider-Man. That's hyphenated, right?
Yeah.
Okay, then you got it. That's five words. I'll give it to you.
Okay,
cool. Well, there you go. That's from the mouth of Eric Leckie here on Venom Talk.
Venom Talk. Ooh, that's another good one. Okay, how about a little SMRT?
I am too smart. I am too smart. SMRT. I mean SMART.
All right.
Okay.
I got a couple of gems for you. Okay, first one. A county DA, so it's a prosecutor. So, you know, they're pretty high-ranking people.
Stands for district attorney, for people that don't know.
Yes. Hey, we've all been under arrest. I mean, wait, we all have, right?
I know an assistant DA, so somebody I can call.
I know a lot of DAs, but it's because I'm standing across from them.
Your mom's usually paying them.
Yeah. So this is takes place in South Carolina.
Okay.
A county DA feared for their life. They had been receiving death threats. They signed a gun out of the sheriff's evidence room.
Okay.
Only to have it stolen.
Oh, God. Are you serious?
Yes. So this case he stole the gun from was still an open case that was being investigated.
Oh,
so
my.
Instead of buying a gun and just having a gun for protection, he's like, who needs to buy a gun? I know where they got lots of guns. The evidence locker.
Okay, well, that's a whole shit ton of wrong things happening right there.
A whole lot of shit tons. What makes it worse was it was stolen because I believe he left it in his car. It was stolen from his vehicle.
Oh, my God.
And now someone is in possession of a firearm that is not registered. It's not traced, meaning they can go commit any crime. It's going to be really tough to get them. That is only going to be in their hands because of someone who represents the DA's office. Because he's the one who signed it out. And the person in the other case can now ask to have their whole case dismissed. They could be a brutal, guilty murderer. They're now going to get their case dismissed because of stolen evidence. That's a lot of F-ups that this person's decision made.
Yes. No, I hope that the DA gets fired for one and charged for whatever it is. Were we tampering with evidence? Being an idiot?
Being an idiot, yes.
What do you do? What are the charges there? Sorry, sir. You're being arrested for just being stupid, man. Like, what are you doing?
My favorite line, though, from the story is the very final line. This guy's name is a District Attorney Wilkins. And it says, after the incident, referring to the gun being stolen and all this shit, all of it, because then that's when he finally had to report it, because he had done all this without saying what he was doing. He was doing this secretly. But once the gun was stolen, he decided, oh my God, now I have to say something. So he knew his career was ending and all that. But the last line of the story in USA Today, D.A. Wilkins did buy his own gun after the firearm had been stolen from his vehicle. Meaning he finally went, well, okay, I might as well buy a gun now.
You know what? I think there's so many things wrong with this. One, this guy should never be in a place of office or in a place of being something that people will want to strive to be. Like, he's a moron, for one. Two, if you're that afraid, then you should step down and move away. Because you're probably corrupt in some sort of way, and you've pissed off enough people that own guns already, and you probably don't even really know how to use a gun. So then
wouldn't you have that fear? Like, I have that fear. I do own weapons. I own guns. I'm not a big gun guy, but I own guns.
So do I.
It would scare the living hell out of me if I had a gun that was stolen or missing. The fear that would be used in some sort of murder or robbery or just anything horrific like that. That's like a deep fear within me.
Yeah, no. Plus,
I couldn't imagine.
Plus, this guy took it from the evidence locker for another case. So, like you said earlier, what if that case was like a triple murder or some guy, you know, if some guy went in there and killed all of his kids or something? Like, that was the gun that was used. Now he can be released on tampering of evidence. Like, why would that even be a good idea?
Get released. Oh, totally going to get released. There's no way that if that other person has a lawyer even half worth their salt. The lawyer just has to doesn't have to say anything. Just like, you're dismissing this, right, Your Honor? And you guys going to go, yeah, I'm dismissing it.
Yeah, right.
But wait a minute. Here's another thought I just had.
Uh-oh.
So wait, let's say – no, it's not.
Light bulb.
Not light bulb. But wait a minute. here's something else that I don't think no one's taking in consideration in the story or anything. In that other trial where the gun was stolen from,
okay,
let's say you're a witness to the crime and they tell you, you know, come out, testify against this guy, this brutal murderer. We're put him away. Don't fear for your life. He's a brutal murderer. We're going to put him away with your evidence. We're going to put him away for life. You have nothing to fear. So you go in there and you testify and you say, that was the man right there that committed this brutal killing. And the bad guy's going to get convicted and everything. And then this happens. And now the guy's going to get released and you're thinking, hey, remember when you told me that I was going to be totally safe? He's now not going to get convicted.
Yeah, no, that doesn't make any sense. Oh man.
Oh, I know. This is going to go so much more wrong, and this guy needs to go to jail for a really long time. That's a horrible. He's just SMRT worthy, where he's just did something really dumb.
Moron. Plus, the other question is this ever going to be brought up to light? Who is this going to be? Because it's election time right now, and people are talking about election, and who's doing this, and who's doing that, and who's Russia controlling this time? Is this even going to come to the surface, or is it just going to be another one of those things where it's like, it's not newsworthy because it's only regional or something? It's like, oh, God, come on, man.
To do a callback from an earlier part of the episode, Another One Bites the Dust.
Wow, look at you. I was just going to say Fat Bottom Girl again.
Ah. Well, they do make the rockin' world go round.
Oh.
The other SMRT story is this is just a quick one. Mama, you know, you just mentioned election season, in which, oh my God, I'm so sick of the ads and everything. But a reporter who's covering a story, which is a story about how difficult it is in America for people to vote. So she's doing the story and she's doing a live shot where she's standing there and she's doing a live shot and whatever. But she's doing it standing in a handicapped parking spot, blocking a handicapped entrance as a guy who is a handicapped war veteran is coming to vote. This guy has no legs. He is coming to vote. And the girl who's doing the story about difficulty in voting is blocking the handicap space.
Oh, my God.
And it's all caught on camera because the guy comes up as they're filming everything. It's great. It's hilarious. Her apology on Twitter, I'm going to read her Twitter. This is Mariana Atencio, who is actually kind of smoking hot, but she's not going to make the list later on because she's an idiot. It says, "We made the wrong call today by using a disabled parking spot for our live shot in Texas. There's no excuse. I apologize to the two people who were on their way to vote, as it's one of the most important parts of our democracy. We'd never want to jeopardize anyone's ability to do so." You could tell that was not written by her. That was legal speak.
Oh, yeah.
The lawyer got to her 100%. A PR firm said, here, I've already worded the tweet from you. It's already typed into your phone. Please just hit the word send.
Yeah, somebody that uses the word jeopardized is not set up in a handicapped parking spot. But this just in, did you find out her and that DA are actually engaged?
Yeah. Oh, look at that. I think their kids are going to be like Three Stooges dumb. Like, they're going to be insanely just dumb.
They're not even one of the three. They're the fourth one that came in to replace one of them. They're the... They weren't even original stooge. They were just
She's kind of hot, though. So, Mariana Atencio, if you would like to apologize to everyone in America for your horrible act, you could start with me. I live in Whittier. And please knock on the door three times, and I'll know it's you, and I'll come outside.
But if you see a sock on the door, you're not supposed to come in. And but you'll have really good Wi-Fi out in front of his house, and the password is 1, 2, 3, 4.
You idiot. No one uses 1, 2, 3, 4. It sounds like someone's luggage combination.
And that's a Spaceballs quote.
Yeah, it is. Spaceballs. Wow. And that's why Chris and I are a good match, because that's why we are gay lovers, because we both
Hey, hey, Spaceballs. Hey.
I don't know about you, but now that I want to prove that I'm not a gay lover of Chris, I would like to do the list.
I wonder who wrote the book out loud.
All right, for those who have not heard the show before, here, let me grab my supplies. What we do at the end of every show is we add a name to our list. Now, this is a list. Let me clarify what the list is for. The list is for people that you would really love to have relations with, but probably never will. And by probably, I mean never.
Never.
never will have a chance to. And I'll give you a couple examples. On my list, I have Scarlett Johansson. Well, duh. Yes. Nev Campbell, Mia Kunis, Evangeline Lilly, Emilia Clarke, Alyssa Milano, Jennifer Love Hewitt, all the people that I fell in love with as a child. Actually, you have Jennifer Love Hewitt on your list. A couple on Eric's list include Michelle Janicki, Daisy Ridley, Zooey Deschanel, Gal Gadot, or however you want to say it. Then you can yell at me online later on if I said it wrong. Sarah Hyland, Ariana Grande. Whoa, you have Ariana Grande. She's single now,
yes,
I heard.
I yeah. So, you got to get while the getting's good.
So basically, we add somebody to our list each week on people that we'd like to have relations with.
If we were using Austin Powers reference.
Consensual.
That's very important. Hashtag me too.
Hashtag yes, what he said. Hashtag what he said about whatever hashtag he was talking about. Like I don't know. Anyway, so this week I'm going to add somebody to my list that I think has been on that list for a very long time, but I don't think I've said it out loud.
Who are you going to drop?
Oh, I got to drop someone. I am going to drop. Oh no, I can't drop her. Can't drop her. Can't drop him. Can't drop. Her.
Can't drop it.
Can't drop it. Juergens. Nope, that's staying on there. You know what? I'm going to drop Michelle Rodriguez just because there hasn't been a Fast and Furious movie in the last couple of years. And, well, honestly, that's the only movie she's doing right now. Yeah. So yeah. I'm going to drop her. She's been on the list for a little while now, since like the sixth or seventh episode. I am typing at the same time. I am trying to stall so I don't mess up my typing here. And I am going to add someone to my list that I wanted to – that's probably been on the list for a long time. I just hadn't said it a lot, like I was saying. Rachel McAdams.
Mm, yeah.
And I think mainly because of The Notebook.
No, that's a you thing. You do that?
What
You're
do you mean?
A watcher of that?
Oh, you know you've seen The Notebook. You didn't have a choice. Your wife made you watch it. No?
The fact that Sandra Kay, a nurse, and Lance Frederick McAdams, the truck driver.
Who's that? Are they married to?
No.
I mean, mom and dad?
I'm just making that up.
You're making stuff up now?
Yeah.
Do you have any idea what you're talking about?
No, I've never seen it. My wife has watched that movie a bunch of times. I'm normally pretty good. We watch almost every movie together. We're not like a we watch movies separate kind of thing. That was the one she watched on her own, and I just never had the interest in watching on my own.
It's actually – oh, God. I can't believe I'm going to say this out loud. It's not a bad flick. It's
you're
definitely
so
a chick flick.
Much of a homosexual.
But she's in it a lot.
And she's really good looking too. She has
very
what I would call like a classic Hollywood beauty. Like if she gets all dolled up, you could picture her in like a vintage dress and like a from another era.
Yeah, no, she's definitely a chameleon when it comes to being in different eras and stuff. She's kind of like a Charlize Theron or Theron or Therenia.
Theronema.
Charlize. So she's like her.
If she gives you an enema, it's a Theronema.
Oh, that's also something. Never mind. I'm not even going to go there. So yeah, so I added Rachel McAdams this week. Who would you like to drop and who would you like to add to your list?
Okay, I'm doing these speed drop and pickups where I'm just picking up people who are relevant in the news cycle and then immediately dropping them. So I am dropping Rooney Mara, who I just picked up last week.
And you're adding Donald Trump.
Yes. Oh, how did you know? I like a man with orange hair and lots of power.
You are a Simpsons fan.
Yeah, I am. Ooh, wow. Well done. So I'm going to add someone, and that's because I ran into this person at a little wine event that I did, and it got me thinking of how hot this person was in the 90s. And she still is incredibly good looking now, but she was younger in the 90s. And I don't know if you'll even remember her name. Her name is Josie Bassett. Now, Josie Bassett was on a show in the 90s that was insanely popular called Melrose Place. She was the blonde not named Heather Locklear
on
Melrose Place. And the reason she is significant is, as part of my young men's sexual awakening period.
When is that going to happen for you again?
I'm still hoping that it comes soon. I mean, just it's and frankly, at this point, I've been waiting 38 years. It's insane. But in the 90s, I never had at this point every woman that I had the hots for always had long hair. And then in the show, she had long hair. But then she got one of her famous haircuts, just like when what's the girl from Friends, the really hot one that you put on your list? Jennifer Aniston.
Jennifer Aniston, okay.
Jennifer Aniston got the haircut, and it was like the rage in Hollywood, and actresses copied and got the haircut.
Everybody
got it. Josie Bassett had a similar thing. She cut off all her hair at Melrose Place and had short blonde hair, and that's kind of what the look she became known for. And then that was the first time when I saw someone, I was like, wow, I like you with short hair. Like, that's good. I like it. You're hot. You're spunky. Women with short hair always seem like they have spunk to them. And she still looks stunning now. But I'm thinking of Josie Bassett from like 1993 Melrose Place.
Yeah, she's an attractive woman. I could honestly tell you I had no idea who she was.
And she's aged very well too. Like she looks very good.
She's 50. She's 48. In case you're wondering. Yeah, she's born in 1970.
Okay, well, there you go. But she looks really hot, and if you look at some old photos of her, long hair or short hair, it's just kind of a nice little look. But she's being added because I literally ran into her, and I saw her, and I'm like, wow, you're still smoking hot. Damn those genetics. And then it made me think of liking her with short hair.
Yeah, no, she's very attractive. Congratulations on your pick this week, Eric.
Thank you. You are now
going to be yelled at by your wife.
Yes, because I had someone I met in person.
Right? You're actually getting closer to maybe happening. No, not maybe happening.
I would also like to bring up that my book has surpassed a very important mark.
You've sold one.
Yes.
Well, I bought one.
No,
so.
You did buy one. So that was – so I sold two, one to me and one to you. No, no. Okay. No, but I have surpassed – so Amazon has their algorithms and they go in increments of 5 – 10, 15, 20, 25, and 25 is the magic number. You want to get to 25 reviews.
Okay.
I have now surpassed this 5 review mark, and I'm up to 7 reviews currently.
Awesome.
So,
congratulations.
There it is.
So 1 from me and 6 from you? Did you do all 6?
Well, me and 5 other fake accounts.
That's okay.
but no, it is hard. You know, in this day and age, reviews, just like reviews on a podcast, are incredibly hard to come by. So this is my opportunity to remind you, please download and subscribe and comment, rate and review on We Should Be Better at This. And please go to Amazon, type in my name, Eric Lecky, and look up Coffee and Cigarettes, my newest book. And please review it. Even if you haven't read it, I don't care. Review it saying 5 stars, haven't read it. I'd be okay with that. I'd be okay if you did 5 stars and said, don't know how to read, never even touched a book before, # make America great again, vote Trump. I'd be fine with that. Just please rate and review.
Okay. Well, that's funny because that's probably what Trump would say if he was going to review your book.
Your book Those is the most amazing book in the world. It's dynamite. It's perfecto. Buy this book.
I'm buying enough to build a wall. I'm going to build a wall with this book. Because it's made with coffee and hookers. No, cigarettes? Hookers? What was it?
Coffee and cigarettes.
Coffee and cigarettes. Well, congratulations, man. I'm so proud of you. You got 7 reviews.
7 reviews. And only one of them is from a family member because even my family will not take the time.
I was going to say that. I was just going to bring it up. But like, and the funny thing is nobody from your family loves the book.
I am now an author of 3 books and 1 screenplay.
Wow.
My wife has read exactly 0 of any of the things that I've ever had published. So
oddly enough, she does watch your old porn videos.
Yes, which is odd. Captain Stubby the Pirate, I didn't think would follow me around this long, but it has. But she will not read my books. I think it's that she's scared to read them, not like them, and then have to tell me she doesn't like them. So she just avoids it completely by never reading them in the first place. So if you think that those reviews are coming from friends and family, they are not.
Well, you know, you did marry up, and she's a smart young lady, so that's probably exactly why she didn't do it. Because I remember many a times in the past where we were going to go do something, and she's like, just stay right here, guys. You guys go kill yourselves or have fun. Yeah. So she's a very smart woman, except for the fact that she married you.
Married me. Yeah, and I think we all agree that that was her one mistake in life. But anyways, please listen next week while I give Chris an enema live on the podcast.
Wait, I didn't sign up for that.
Engineer Mike, did we alert Chris that that's what we were going to do next week?
And
he's shaking his head no. We did not know that you didn't know, but it is going to be groundbreaking. It'll be good for the podcast. It'll get ears on it. So please tune in where we do a live on-air enema.
That's not going to happen, people, so don't do that, please. But tune in, rate, review, follow me on Twitter, Chris_Donovan. Buy his book if you have an extra $15.
$12.99.
Well,
what a deal.
You know what? I have a promo code. I hit up Amazon.
#go screw yourself.
Suck.
Thank you, everybody, for following along, and we will talk to you in a week's time. If we feel like it. If you're lucky enough, we'll allow you to listen.
And it might be sooner if one of us gets fired.
Yeah, even better.
All right.
All right, everybody. Have a good week.
Catch you later. You know we take it to the top. You know we make the parties hot. Tell me on. Happy birthday! How can it be?
Judy was boring.
Hello.
Then Judy discovered Chumbacasino.com.
It's my little escape.
Now Judy's the life of the party.
Oh, baby, mama's bringing home the bacon.
Whoa, take it easy, Judy. The Chumba life is for everybody. So go to Chumbacasino.com and play over 100 casino-style games. Join today and play for free for your chance to redeem some serious prizes. Chumbacasino.com. No purchase necessary. Void where prohibited by law. 18 plus terms and conditions apply. See website for details.